Let's say amen for him.
Brother
Right, you're not.
Yep, yep, y'all see that? All right, Brother Doug and Sister Norman, there's some wonderful people. They're always reaching out, getting somebody here. And this morning they persuaded Brother Leonard to come. Shut up, Brother Leonard. And
Pam.
Pam, okay. Brother Leonard and Sister Pam, I want y'all to stand.
Okay, good, good, good. Now, if we could get all of our members to just do what they have done, wouldn't it be wonderful?
Yes.
All right, so we're going to be challenging our members. Brother Leonard, we kind of know him from way back when our house was burned. He was the one that we stored our furniture with, and he delivered our furniture. And we were just wondering, how in the world can we get this furniture that we bought? We bought some furniture before we knew we could get it in the house. And we were just in a quandary, how are we going to get that furniture in our house? And Brother Leonard was the head man that came over and maneuvered until they got that furniture. I mean, if you want somebody to move some furniture, amen, you call on Brother Leonard, and he will definitely. And also, Brother Don, yesterday, I had a van that was just parked because I figured it would be about $2,000 to get it fixed, so I didn't deal with it. And he came over yesterday, got that van running for less than $100. Man, you know I love Brother Doug. And boy, I'm telling you, blessings are coming from all different directions. So we underestimate ourselves when we think that it's not important to reach out. Just see the blessings that's already happening among us just by just a few people reaching out. Amen. So the scripture says, he that winneth souls is wise. All right. So I have really felt the importance of the saints really coming together on a consistent basis. And I'm going to follow through with this. I started this last week. Those that don't show up on Bible study night, you need to give an account of yourself. Call us, let us know the reason why you're inconsistent. You need to call us. We want you to develop a sense of responsibility, accountability. And if you don't call, you don't come, I'm going to be on the phone. Because I'm held accountable for your souls. And I appreciate the Browns because they said yesterday, I asked what day would they be able to come. And they right off said, well, Wednesday evening is a good time. 7 o'clock. They made a commitment to come on Wednesday evening. And this is what we're going to be asking for all of you and those that can come on Wednesday evening, Wednesday morning at 10. Everybody just say Wednesday morning at 10. For those that can't come Wednesday night and Friday, Sunday evening, probably we will announce when we will begin, but we're going to hold that hour open 5 o'clock. And we don't want nobody operating in this church doing anything for trying to do something for God without positioning yourself for God to do something for you. You have to be obedient. And I'm going to hold you to that because God is holding me accountable. And nobody in this church, I don't want nobody doing nothing if you can't obey the pastor, if you can't be under authority in submission. And one of the criteria is that you need to be here when you're supposed to be here. And without the fivefold ministry gifts, without pastors teaching, and without the fellowship of the saints, without fellowshiping with the word, amen, there can be no growth on your part in terms of placing yourself in a position to fulfill the call of God in your life. All right, so how does that sound? How many mad at me? All right, well, that's what the Lord quickened to me, because the Lord said, I'm going to hold you accountable if you let people do all of these things and half obey and not be faithful and committed. And you have been given authority over them. All right, well, thank you for receiving it. And we just want to continue to share in the area of soul winning. Amen. We're going to be talking about soul winning today and the importance of soul winning and the things that you can do in order to be more effective in your quest to win souls. Father, we thank you today. We give you praise. We give you the glory. In Jesus' name, we thank you, Lord, for beginning the good work within us. And you who have begun the good work shall continue to perform it. Father, we thank you that your eyes are upon the righteous and your ears are open to their cry. The righteous cry, the Lord heareth them and delivereth them out of all of their troubles. Lord, we thank you for that open door. We thank you, God, for that listening ear. For we can come boldly before your presence to ask for grace and mercy to help us in the time of need. We give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 All right. I just want to share something with you that's going to be a real blessing. Now, I feel that the commandment to go into all of the world, last week, Sister Denise spoke from that scripture. I don't think that that is optional. I think it's a command, and I think it's the primary purpose that God has raised us up and called us from darkness to light. I don't think that there's no assignment that God has given us that even compared to the commission, great commission of going into all of the world and what, preaching the gospel. We don't know, we don't believe that we have to go to Africa and all over the world in that respect, you know. But the part of the world that you are part of, people that you are connected with, people that you rub shoulders with, people that you come in contact with, and people that are around you, I think it's important for us to be constantly on guard to get the word to them, amen, before it's going to be eternally too late. Now, you might not understand the call in its fullness, but the call is to every believer. Every believer. The call is to go into all of the world and preach the gospel. Now, in other words, the gospel basically is the fact that Jesus Christ has died for you. He has become sin for you, who knew no sin, so that you might be made the righteousness of God in Christ. In other words, he's made it possible for you to stand before God without a sense of sin. Amen. And for you to operate and to function as a believer, amen, without a sense of inferiority and without a sense of intimidation or feeling that you are unworthy or you are not about anything. It gives you boldness before the throne of God, and that's a big issue. Amen. Having boldness, yes. Amen, to carry out God's will without being intimidated by the devil or to be under the influence of fear from people. Amen. So God has raised up Jesus, amen, and he has made it possible for us to have life and for us to carry out the Great Commission and do fulfill our call, amen, without feeling inferior or without feeling that we are not up to the, you know, the standard that we can actually function as a believer. Amen. Now, I believe that it's possible for us to reach the lost. I really believe that. I really believe that we have the ability to convince people and to speak to people and bring conviction to their hearts. I really believe that. Because when we are filled with the Holy Ghost and when we are walking in faith, amen, I believe that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. You know, it's not going to be about who we are or how much intelligence or wisdom or knowledge or ability, amen. You know, you don't have to be a gifted talker. Sometimes a lot of people have a gift of gab. They can really talk. They can almost sell anybody anything. Amen. But I think that as a believer, I believe that if you actually are filled with the Holy Ghost and you are faithful to God and you really have a burden and a passion for people, yes, And I believe that that's very, very important to live your life in fear and not wanting to see people around you perish and lose their soul and die and be alienated from God throughout eternity. I don't think anybody want any person that they know, amen, that they really have grown to love, actually spend eternity separated and alienated from God. It was a person that said this. He said that he was thinking about a minister that was very callous in his, in fact, it was a criminal that was condemned to death, to die on a gallows. And the minister was assigned the last rites. He had to minister to this criminal just before he would, fall from his death. I mean, they would hung him, and then, of course, from that point, he would fall into hell, you know, his spirit would. This minister was very callous. He didn't have no passion, no concern. He didn't feel the destiny that this man no doubt was facing, because this man was a criminal, and he had never heard the gospel, had never had an opportunity to hear anybody, amen, share the gospel of Jesus Christ with him. And this minister was just cold-hearted. I mean, he could care less. I mean, all he was concerned about was performing that rite and just going through the motion and going through the form, formality, amen. And that man was about to fall in hell, and he was going to perish throughout eternity, amen, in fire, and not ever being able to reverse his condition, amen. And this man was just cold-hearted. And somebody stood up and said, if I was a believer, if I was a ministry, if I was just a believer, and somebody was in this condition about ready to lose out eternally, and we knew that their destiny meant a destiny of in the lake of fire forever, in hell and in the lake of fire, this person that wasn't even saved said that I would be willing to get on my knees and crawl on my knees on glass from the East Coast to the West Coast on my knees, on glass, in order to rescue one person from hell and from the lake of fire. Amen. And many times this kind of reflects the destiny of believers. They really don't really have that passion. They can't place themselves in the position of a sinner and visualize the destiny that these people are going to be facing immediately after they breathe their last, breath. Amen. So we just want us to be aware that we need to awaken that passion. We need to get that passion awakened in us and really begin to sympathize and empathize with people that do not know the gospel. And this is the focus of our teaching, and we just want all of you to know that this is very vital, very vitally important, because we believe that many sinners are at the brink of eternity, and many of them have never, amen, had a chance to hear the gospel. Now, I want you to turn to the scriptures, and I want you to turn to Deuteronomy 10, 12, and 13. Now, we need to know why God has enabled us to experience eternal life and to enjoy the life that we enjoy in Him. Now, many times we really don't understand that we want you to turn to Deuteronomy 10, and we're just going to read that in just a minute. But I want to say the time period we have been given to be here on earth is a period of time to determine your fitness to serve God throughout eternity without sin. See, we're only here 70, 80, or 90 years, but that short period of time is the time period in which God will determine whether you will be able to serve Him throughout eternity. See, That's a short period compared to eternity. So this period of time that we have been given, which is a short period of time, is to be lived in fear. I mean, we are really, we really need to understand why we are here and the purpose that God has created us. We really need to understand. Because this period of time is the time that God determines whether you will serve Him, well, you will be obedient, that you would be accounted worthy, you would be worthy of eternal responsibility in connection with the earth and God's kingdom. Now, what you do during this period of time is going to determine whether God can trust you, whether you will serve God willingly, whether you will be counted worthy of eternal responsibilities in the life to come. Now, that's going to be millions and billions and trillions and quadrillions and quintillions and sextillions and hextillions years. I mean, it will be throughout eternity. And you're going to be actually, amen, living, and you're going to be aware of your existence, and you're going to have to be in some position or doing something or experiencing something throughout eternity. And what you do during those 70, 80, 90 years, whatever time period that God gives you, amen, will determine what God will be able to trust you with, whether you will be able to serve Him, whether you will be able to carry out eternal responsibilities during that long, I mean, during the millennium. We know that is the case, and also throughout eternity. Amen. So what you do in this life, how many, amen, are with me? How many know what you do in this life is what is really, really important? The decisions you make, the life you live, amen, your knowledge and wisdom of the Word of God, your fear of God, all of these things are very, very important. Now, we can loaf off and waste the time and just live as though that there's no eternity if we want to, but we're going to have to give an account. Everybody will have to meet God in judgment. There's going to be about five different judgments, and I'm not going to take time now to enumerate all of them, but every person in this building, you're going to have to stand before, amen, God in judgment, and you're going to have to give an account of the life you live. Amen. And there's a lot of opportunities God has given us, amen, to position ourselves, amen, to reap in the life and to position ourselves to serve Him, amen, in responsible roles throughout eternity. Amen. But if we, amen, do not make the right decisions and make the right choices in this life and really obey God and serve Him willingly, and be willing to subject ourselves to inconvenience and, amen, and suffering and pain and hardship in order to place ourselves in a position where God can count us worthy of what? Serving Him in, praise God, in the times to come. Amen. So I just want you to know that your personality, your nature, your character, all of that will be determined during this trial period, or the period that we call probation, and God will know where you are, how you stand, and whether you will be counted worthy, whether you could be trusted in positions, amen, in the kingdom, in, praise God, in eternity. God can ascertain that. This is how He ascertained that. By your obedience, by your willingness to serve Him in this life, by your faithfulness. Oh, amen. Turn to somebody and say, amen, you're stepping on toes. It's on my toes, man. If you're not faithful in this life, then God knows you're not going to be faithful. Amen. He can't trust you to be faithful in the life to come. So it's kind of important, saints, for you to what, show up when you're supposed to show up. Now, the little prayer meetings we have, and they're not nearly, amen, all that we need to be doing. Y'all know that. All right. Because in the book of Acts, if you really want to understand the motto and how we should conform and pattern our lives and the example that we should follow. We can just look at the book of Acts, and the Bible says they continued daily on one accord, steadfast in the apostles' doctrine, breaking of bread and prayers. Amen. And the Bible says, and souls were added to the church every day. They ceased not to teach and to preach Jesus from house to house. They ceased not. Amen. So we want to understand that we are on probation, and this life determines what God will be able to how God will be able to use us in the life to come. And some, as we know, that won't obey, amen, and that reject the word of God and that fail to live up to the word, they will not even be in the kingdom, period. They will not inherit eternal life. Okay, Deuteronomy 10, 12, it says, and now Israel, what doth the Lord thy God require of thee, but to fear the Lord thy God. Okay, to fear the Lord thy God, to walk in all of his ways, it is a part of them. And that's the motivation that we have. Amen. In order to please God, you need to be listening to everything your pastor is saying, everything your teachers are saying. I mean, if it's according to the word. Amen. You need to be reading your Bible on a consistent basis and really walking in the fear of God and doing all that you know that God has called you to do. Amen. You know, the grace of God is the motivation behind all of this. We can do all things through Christ that what strengthens us. Okay, to keep the commandments of, and, amen, to fear the Lord thy God, to walk in how many of his ways? And to what? Love him. And to what? Serve the Lord thy God with all of thy heart and with all of thy what? Soul. That's the thing that God is looking for. And he's given you tools. He's given you the ability, the power, amen, to please him. The grace of God is the thing that all of us have been given. And verse 13 says this, to keep the commandments of the Lord and his what? Statutes, which I command thee this day for thy good. All right, so that's the thing that God is looking for. In fact, this is the reason why God has placed us here for a season, for a period of time. Amen. To carry out his will and to fulfill the purpose that he has raised us up for.
Yes.
Amen. We are made for God's glory. Is that right? We're not made to just go through life having fun and doing what we want to do and pleasing ourselves. Bible says it's once appointed unto man to die, but after death, then what? The judgment. We're here for a purpose. Everybody can say, I'm here for a purpose. I'm here for a purpose. And that purpose is to, amen, do exactly what's stated in this particular verse, to fear the Lord thy God. Fear the Lord means to a wholesome dread of displeasing God. Jesus said, I always do those things that pleases my Father.
Amen.
Amen. We need to understand the things that God is expecting of us and how we can really what? Begin to walk in harmony with those things that God clearly has what? Amen. Has called us to do while we have this limited period here on earth. We never know when God is going to call us on. Is that right?
Yeah.
So we need to walk every day and to live our lives in what? Fear. A wholesome dread of what? Displeasing God.
Right.
And I believe that if we would walk in fear, walk in all of his ways, and to seek to love him and to serve the Lord, amen, thy God, with all thy heart and with all thy soul, I believe that that will be a great motivation in causing us to what? Do whatever we need to do, whatever justice we need to make, whatever choices that we need to make, amen, whatever decisions that we need to make, I think that we will begin to be a lot more diligent. I'm going to tell you one thing. You're not going to come close to pleasing God if you never, hallelujah, understand the importance of the fivefold ministry gift. If you don't value pastors, if you don't think you need their teachings, if you think that it's okay for you to skip whatever you want to, See, faithfulness. Now, you know, I was out for about 4 or 6 weeks, man. I don't understand how people can miss, because I'm the pastor, and I failed. Like, amen, praise God. But I was, my fellowship was impacted by not being able to come and to fellowship with the saints. The saints, prayer meetings, Bible studies, all of these comments, all of these expectations you hear, and all the contact you have with one another, amen, this is the thing that what? Caused you to what? Really experience, amen, the fullness of God.
Amen.
I can't make it. The first night I came back after being out for about 6 weeks and prayed with the saints, my life changed. My faith, amen, praise God, went to another level.
Yes.
I was motivated. Strength began to flow into me.
Amen.
And from that, praise God, it seemed like, amen, praise God, I got a stronger hold on the Lord. It's important, saints. I mean, it's important for us to not slack off in assembling ourselves together, amen, with the saints. I believe that's Hebrews 10:25. That's very, very important. Amen. The scripture says, if we walk in the light as he is in the light, then we have fellowship one with another. Amen. And the blood of Jesus Christ will cleanse us from all sin. So it's important for us to walk in fellowship with the Word, fellowship with Jesus, fellowship with God, fellowship with the saints, fellowship with the Holy Ghost. Amen. We've got to walk in fellowship. Amen. And the Bible says, then, amen, the blood of Jesus will cleanse us from what? All sin. All right, this is Hebrews 10:25. It says, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together. And this is, the Bible says that this generation, the Philadelphia church, which is what? Lukewarm. They're not cold or hot. Amen. They don't, amen. They are not like the example that we see in Acts. The Philadelphia church, the church that Jesus will find here when he comes back, it's going to be a lukewarm church, because the cares of life, the deceitfulness of riches, and the lust of other things, amen, have what? Choked out the word of God, and people's minds are not on what? Things that really, praise God, are designed to what? Get them into the kingdom. Their minds are not on it. They're caught up in what? Pleasure. Bible says, love not the world, not other things that are in the world. If any man loveth the world, the love of the Father is not in it. And all that's in the world, the lust of the eyes, the what? Lust of the flesh and the pride of life is not of God. Amen. It's of the world.
Yeah.
And these things are going to pass away, and we're going to be what? Left hanging.
Come on.
Amen. Praise God. Without a firm hope on the Lord. And I want you to understand verse 25 in Hebrews 10:25. Let's read it again. Not forsaken, everybody together. Not what? Forsaken. The assembling of what? Ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. I mean, the day of Christ. We can see the signs of the time on every hand.
Amen.
Jesus is going to soon to come. And we as a church overall, all over, the Bible predicted it, that it will be a lukewarm church. Lukewarm. And I was really blessed. Sister Brianna, she was here Thursday morning, and she went so, amen, weak there. I would let her talk. But she said that the Lord just impressed upon me that we need a lot more fervency.
Amen. Amen.
Y'all looking at me so strange. That we are too soft and timid, and we need each other back, and lukewarm and cold. Take it or leave it type of attitude. And that hunger, that passion, is lacking and is missing. And we don't see the need. Now, when it was missing in me, praise God, because I was out, I came back where the fire was. You know, everything ain't quite like we want it to be. You know, I wish we had a lot more fervency, but the little bit we got, hey, I'm going to take advantage of that.
Amen.
I mean, just say amen. And I can see some every once in a while. Somebody got sincere. The Bible says it is effectual fervor. Boy, this is a day that we need some fervency. The Bible says he that goeth forth weeping and bearing what precious seed shall doubtless come again with what? Rejoicing. You can't win nobody now if you're what? Lukewarm, hearted. I believe God can give you a conviction and a passion that calls people to what? Listen to what you got to say. I believe you can arrest people's attention if you are what? If you got something, hallelujah, on the inside of you, that's what? Burn! We can testify, thank the Lord for being here. You might remember this, brother. After being here, you finally saved and sanctified and filled with the Holy Ghost. Filled with the Holy Ghost and fire. And we need some fire. How many can say amen? We need some passion. We need something that will drive us, motivate us, make us get up at 5 o'clock sometime and come out and pray.
Amen.
Come out and pray.
Come on.
Y'all looking at me. Y'all will be looking at me from now on, but you'll never get up 5 o'clock, 4:30. You will turn over and go back to sleep. Bible said if we suffer with them, we'll reign with them. Whosoever cometh after me, let him first deny himself. Take up the cross. You know what? I won't suffer. Amen. Go to no inconvenience. Pay no price. Now, if I had been a pastor, amen, that didn't want to pay the price, that didn't deny myself of my rest, my sleep, and even finances. Because if the money is not there for me to get paid, I don't get paid.
Come on.
And do I be complaining, bawling, and squalling, and threatening to leave? I've been doing this for years.
Come on.
You can tell the mark of somebody that's sincere, amen, if they praise God, will hang in there when the money ain't right, when there's no money.
Come on.
And you're doing that not because of what? The money. You're doing it because of what? God has placed on you that responsibility, and you're not going to run away from it, and you're not going to turn your back on it because somebody won't obey God. God told me to praise God that I got to be faithful unto death, and then I'll get a crown of life. I want to, amen, I want my crown. Hey, hey, hallelujah. Hey, hallelujah. And the more hardships I go through, the more not a real big one. It's not like being beaten and discouraged and talked about and rejected and hallelujah, stoned to death like the old prophets and apostles had to do. We don't have nothing harder to suffer now. But y'all think getting up at 5 o'clock, oh man, that's just like being stoned. But I tell you, if you don't suffer, you're not going to reign. If you don't pay no price, hallelujah, praise God, that power, amen, whatever example Jesus gave us, amen, the servant is not above his master. If he had to suffer, the Bible says, it's not appointed us just to believe on his name, but to what? Suffer for his sake. If you don't suffer, if you're not willing to go through these 2 and 3 days fast every once in a while, stop eating and stop eating fast. Now that's one reason why many times we are so timid, we need each other back and don't have the anointing even to, amen, hallelujah, to do it. It's because we're not willing to make no sacrifices.
That's it. All right.
It's kind of sacrifices. Everybody just say, sacrifices. Ask people to come on Wednesday night consistently. I'm not sure if I can commit to something like that every week. In the Bible, they came every day. And souls were saved every day. They ceased not to preach Jesus every day. And every day, hallelujah, people were coming into the kingdom. Now, amen, how many ever won a soul? Don't even look. Don't even raise your hand. Get embarrassed. And when the pastor gets a burden, because when you kind of stay in a position where you can really hear God, God began to show you all the pitfalls, all of the things that we are, amen, missing out in. See, some of us think that this type of environment, whatever is routine for us here, amen, I think that we are a church that perhaps try to make people more accountable, and we, you know, all these prayer meetings, and we got some brothers here and some ministers here that really believe in prayer. Tuesday morning at 5 o'clock. You have the same two. How many is that? 3, 4, or 6. And amen. And this church is, how many here are members? Most of y'all are members?
Yeah. All right.
How many of you have on Tuesday morning, brother?
Two.
Okay. Y'all heard that too. How many souls are being saved every day or every week, every month? How many? How many? Okay, now, what's the problem, Brother Curtis? What's the problem? Brother Curtis, this is my ass. What's the problem? People just don't want to get up. They don't want to pay the price. They don't want to deny that flesh.
Come on.
That flesh says, Satan is faking. Somebody said, well, my spirit is willing. A flesh is weak.
That's it.
That's the reason why they used to call us Pentecostals. Now they call us calls to death. No fire, no flame, no zeal, no fervency. Because what? We're not willing to what? To pay the price. Now, I'm going to tell you three things that God is calling every believer to do. There are three. If you turn to Ezekiel 3:18, you'll see that. This is the responsibility that every believer has, because the sacrifice for suffering, hallelujah, and laying down your life.
Yes.
Paul said, I count not my life as dear. Bible said that we're not to live our lives unto ourselves. We're not to please ourselves, but we're to please him who has what? Died for us.
Yes, Lord.
And rose again. We have a gospel that works. We have a Jesus that still lives. Hallelujah. We have a hallelujah, a faith, hallelujah, that will work and that can turn people's lives around. Hey, hallelujah. The Bible says the gospel is the power of God unto salvation to everybody that believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. I'm not ashamed of it, because it's the power of God.
Yes.
It's not in word only.
Come on.
Kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness, what? Joy.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Peace in the Holy Ghost.
Yes,
the gospel will work, but if we are cold and so, amen, lukewarm and timid, weak, need to jet it back, don't want to pay no price, don't want to get up in the morning, don't even want to, too lazy to even read the Bible.
All right.
And we asked, I'm going to ask how many hands, and we said, let's read the list of the gospels in this, just in the book of Matthew. The book of Acts. Those hands go up. How many hands will go up? I see one. Amen. You know, so I hope I'll be glad when this is over. All right. There's no way you can get around Ezekiel 3:18 through 21. I want somebody to read that to me. See, there are three categories of people that God is holding us accountable. Yes. Ezekiel 3:18.
When I say unto the wicked.
Okay, when I say unto the wicked, okay.
Thou shalt surely die.
Thou shalt. The wicked, and the wicked is going to die.
And thou givest him not warning.
And you, thou givest him not warning.
Nor speak it to warn the wicked man from his wicked ways.
Nor speak it to warn the wicked man from his wicked way.
To save his life.
To save his life.
The same wicked man shall die in his iniquity.
Mm.
But his blood will I require at thine hand.
Okay, just keep on reading.
Yet if thou warn the wicked, and he turn not from his wickedness, nor from his wicked way, he shall die in his iniquity, but thou hast delivered thy soul. Again, when a righteous man doth turn from his righteousness and commit iniquity, I will lay a stumbling block before him, he shall die, because thou hast not given him warning. He shall die in his sin, and his righteousness which he hath done shall not be remembered. But his blood will I require at thine hand.
Okay, if you look at that passage, that was Ezekiel 3, 18 through what? 20. Okay, is that all in it?
Nevertheless, if thou warn the righteous man that the righteous sin not, and he doth not sin, he shall surely live, because he is warned. Also, thou hast delivered thy soul.
Okay, now, if you investigate and break that down, you'll find three categories of people that the watchman is supposed to be what? Responsible for. I'm going to say that again. Three categories. The first one is the sinner that what? That's lost and doesn't know it. Or the sinner that's lost and can't help it. Or the sinner that's lost and can't do nothing about it. It's the sinner that has never heard. And you would be surprised of how many people, 75% of the world's population, have not heard the gospel. A testimony like you have concerning how God saved you, turn your life around in all of the mess that God released you and delivered you from. They haven't heard as much as a testimony. Not even a clear-cut presentation of the gospel. Now, many times in the church, okay, the lost is somebody that we perhaps feel that it's got to be a certain type of person, a certain call in your life, a certain gap, a gift of gab you have to have before you are capable of reaching that particular category. But we see in the examples that we gave on Wednesday night that the little maid from the land of what? Israel, that was in Syria, and she was Naaman's wife. She was the one that what? Pointed her master, who had leprosy, to a source where he could what? Recover from his leprosy. No experience. I mean, they didn't even have a name for her. They just said a little maid. But she what? Pointed the way. And that master who had leprosy was able to recover. Not only did he recover from his leprosy, but also he was what? He was brought to the point where he knew that the gods that he was serving were what? Idol gods, and he was willing to what? To turn from his idolatry and to turn to the true and living God. How many can say hallelujah, praise God to that? Hallelujah. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Now, the other area is those that have been saved and they have what? Backslidden. Backslid means to what? Slide back. It's a whole lot of people what? Ain't where they used to be. Oh, a whole lot of backsliders. I mean, right. I'm not looking at none, am I? Well, if you're not sliding, going forward, you're what? Slide back. You know, we've forsaken the prayer meeting, we've forsaken Bible study, we watch on TV, we carry the flight, we deceive themselves, riches, the lust of other things. Every once in a while, you know, praise God, God becomes important to us. We have a whole lot to work with. I mean, you can get on the telephone, I mean, and you will keep you busy day and night writing notes after your turn. That's a job. If you're looking for a job, if you want to serve the Lord, and the Bible says, fear the Lord, walk in all of his ways, and what? Amen. Praise God. And what? Keep him keeping all of his commandments and all of that, you got a whole slew of people right here in Northside. Just get on the phone. Ask Sister the prayer to start calling. Last week of all the people that didn't show up last night. And that's a job. Everybody said, that's a job. And I don't care and I don't want it. Well, how are you going to stay on fire if you don't what? If you're not giving out, if you always what? Receiving, always what? Want somebody to what? Bless you, but you don't want to what? Be a blessing to others. How many know if you want to stay on fire, you got to what? You got to what? You got to put out something. You got to share with people. You got to what? Warn them. Admonish them. Encourage them. Build them up. Talk. Amen. Call them and talk about it. How many got a call from me, sister? You've been a member of this church? Look how many hands are going up. And I'm going to start calling probably every week when you don't show up, because you don't realize the importance of you being in place and getting edified and motivated and hearing all of these scriptures that I'm reading. You might not think that you need them. You might not need to think that you need to be in one of Brother Travis' prayer meetings, Brother William's Sunday school. But you need everything you can get at, and we don't even have everything quite you need here at Northside Christian Center. And you don't get this no bit. Lord Jesus. All right, how many know that the lost should be a focus group? Every opportunity to speak a word for the Lord to people that you know, come in contact with, that you rub shoulders with, people that you live close to, people that, amen, praise God, that you fellowship with, that's related to you. Amen. Those are people that God is holding you accountable for. I know that you've heard this over and over and over. Amen. But I think that we have to hear the gospel repeatedly over and over and over. All right. The third group is the group that we focus on all the time. And I believe because you focus on people that are coming to Bible study, people that's in the Bible classes, people that come to church, and people that come to the prepping, because we focus on them, I think that's wonderful, because they need to be encouraged to what? To keep holding on, to keep what? Coming, to keep in the Word, to keep praying, keep seeking God, and keep reaching out and all of that. I think that's wonderful. Amen. But there are two classes that what? We don't even consider it. And God told us to what? To do it.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
All right. Now, turn to 1 Corinthians 3, and I'm going to... See, there are three, everybody said there are three categories. There are three classes of people that I need to be focusing on. That's the lost. Everybody said the lost.
The lost.
Say it again, the lost.
The lost.
I need to figure out how I can get what? Connected with the lost. Reaching out, it's not a big deal. You have sinners everywhere. You have people that need the Lord everywhere. And I'm holding everybody accountable. I'm going to just ask you, have you talked to anybody this month? Sister, hold your hand up. All right, Sister Yvonne, she come to your house?
Yes.
She came to your house, what did she do?
Well, she came out with her hair, but my husband said, he told me about the visit. He said, if the ladies came by and prayed with me, and they wanted to church.
All right.
They came by the house. I was at work, and it was Sister Denise and Kate, and they prayed with my husband. And when I got home that evening, he said, I had some ladies come by and pray with me, and they go to church up there in Northside and want us to come. I said, I ain't coming. You go. Yeah, he went.
What happened to
him? He went several Sundays, and he kept coming back. He said, you ought to come over. And at the end, Pastor Hill and Sister Hill came over. And I kind of gave them a rough time, because he was trying to explain to me why God needed help through his son. So he kind of broke it down like a cake.
All right. Now, this lady here was pretty tough, but we had to hang in there. And we kept hanging in. We kept hanging in. most faithful, committed, staunch, supporter member. Yes, last week she was up there at the MC.
Yes, amen.
Suppose we had just what? Let it go. Not hung in there. How did mama get hooked up? Yeah. Okay, you kept telling mom. All right, what did mom say? All right, mom. Amen. Woo! Amen. Hallelujah. Now, okay, how do y'all get here? How do y'all get here?
Sister Hill was out witnessing. Stopped by my mom's house.
Cold.
All right. It was a cold winter day. Last house on the.
What did your mama do?
Well, she said there was some ministers that came by.
How did you get hooked up with y'all?
Well, through her. And then I talked to her, and I came by and listened to you guys. And they made my family came to this.
All right. So if we hadn't been concerned about the laws, going out and making what? Cold contact, more than likely, we never would have known.
We got a beautiful
daughter,
Mom.
Oh, yeah. Was that before or after?
That was nothing.
That was after. I guess it had to be after. All right. What a beautiful daughter-in-law. All right. All right. And we got, oh, Lord Jesus. See, we could have missed out on all of that chain reaction. By what? Sitting up in here, just what? Talking to you only. And 7, 8, or 9, or 10 that comes. A 20 or whatever it is. See, that's the fallacy. That's the mistake we make when we just focus on what? The save.
That's right.
Y'all don't believe that. Amen. Some of us just what? Just focus. I mean, we got 30 years just focus on the save. Amen. And the save that we're focusing on, you can't kind of get a little with a dog beat out of there in terms of motivate them when they hear and 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 don't do and don't do and don't do and don't do. What happened? You just end up spinning your wheels. How did you get here?
Yeah, my wife was saying, I made money in the streets. She wouldn't take it. See, that's the devil's money. Yeah, she wouldn't take my latest dress. All the money she went with her, man,
one day God
told me to go to church. I went to church, not me.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right. Now, don't tell me your testimony won't impact the Lord. Brother Travis, just come down here for a minute. Brother Travis, how many times you came by this church and saw all these cars here? You wondered what's going on? And you probably made up your mind. I'll never be seen down in that church. All right. Hundreds of times you passed up and down this street. Okay, what kind of fellow were you? Be sure, I know it took you an hour or two to tell it. name some of the stuff you were doing.
Like Brother Beauty, I was selling used drugs, clubbing, partying, doing everything that I could, you know, whatever gave me pleasure, I did it. I was into some everything. Everything but murder, charity, kidnapping, that kind of stuff. I wasn't doing that again.
Well, how do you get up here?
Well, my late wife introduced me to this church. We were coming on first, and she was, when she started here, she was ashamed of our relationship, and she didn't want to be seen with me. So in order to write that shit, she invited me to church. And God had already spoke my heart about if I didn't change my ways, that I was going to die. And I knew I was dying fast. But thanks to Paulette, she introduced me to Northside. I became a born again Christian. Easter Sunday 2002. And, yes. The church is gave me life through this ministry. Life gave a show this side of life that I never thought was possible, you know, for the life I was living. You know, so God can take you out of darkness and put you in the light. You know, if you shine the light on me, he can shine the light on you. The light is not reserved for the rich, the wealthy. It's reserved for the lost, the hungry, the bitter, the angry, and the forgotten. Amen.
All right. Now, the church that you passed by hundreds of times figured out, you know, what in the world those people are doing. I'll never be a part of that. Whatever it is, I never will. But now he has the key to the church. And he opens up the church for every prayer meeting almost. All right, Brother Henry, when you first step door, step your foot in this place in the back, I believe. What happened to you?
I'm moving furniture. What happened is when I was moving the furniture, I just got this overwhelming feeling, like I wanted to cry. And I told Pastor, I don't know where this came from, that he didn't deserve to have to pick this furniture. It should be given to him. And I never felt like that before, one at a time, when I talked to my grandmother. And then he said, wow. And I found me a church right there and there.
All right. All right. Hallelujah. All right. Now here's my friend here. Okay, one night you came here. I don't know whether you were married or y'all fixing to get married, and something happened to you. I know you were baptized in the Holy Ghost earlier in your life, but just tell us what happened in your life. Even that Holy Ghost night that God hit you. But I never heard nobody speak in tongues as fluently as this brother here. What hit you? What came over you? And what was that all about?
Well, I've been looking for a church home, and when I met my future wife online, she suggested that I come and visit, and I visited, and liked the church, and I liked the praise, and the word-based ministry, and, you know, Pastor Hill worked with me to bring back what had been lost to me. which was that infilling of the Holy Spirit. And, you know, if you don't have that in your life, you have no joy. There's no joy.
Amen.
And that's what I was looking for, and I found it here. Well, I don't have to finish this sermon. Y'all finish it. Wasn't that good? Wasn't that good? All I want to say is that Jesus has paid the price, laid down his life, committed his love toward us. While we were yet sinners, he died for us. And if he died for us, laid down his life, he ought to be worthy for us to what? Lay down our lives. For those around us, that's perishing. If you're not saved today, if you don't know Christ and a part of your sin, after witnessing and hearing all that God has done in the lives of all of those that gave that testimony, if you, praise God, have been convinced and convicted, hallelujah, that you need to make a start, God wants to use you. You have a responsibility of the people around you that you know. Amen. You know people that we don't know. Hallelujah. You can cause people. For instance, if we had reached the whole bunch, I'm not even sure whether we would have ever, amen, had the privilege of having our wonderful daughter-in-law. And two beautiful grandsons. Hallelujah. How can you say amen? Grandson is kind of the talk of the city. I'm not trying to boast, but everywhere you go, they're talking about them Hill brothers. And that football and their ability to, amen, praise God, to win the game. I mean, it's far and near. Last week, Sister Hill said that, Derek said that somebody came up to him. It was a white person. So I can't get here. You know, Derek was playing. I came here to see Hill play. If he don't play, they come up to him. I came here to see Hill play. He's the one that make all the touchdowns and win all the games practically. Hey! Him and his brother, Justice and Dax. Amen. But at this time, there are those of you, when I was 21 years old, I made the commitment to give the Lord my life. I never believed that I would ever be saved. Amen. I was raised in the church, and my mother and father, all of them were leaders of the church, and they kept admonishing me, come, give your life to Christ. All of my sisters and brothers, except for my younger sister, all of them gave their lives to the Lord when they were in their youth. But I was so different, so full of pride. I didn't want nobody to see me, amen, receive the Lord, because I thought I would break down and cry and weep, or sometimes people fell on the floor. They used to call them holy rollers. And they used to fall out on the floor and roll all over the floor, got dirty and foam at the mouth. I said, no, I don't want none of that stuff. For all of my teenage life, I just even held it in. But the Bible says the way of a transgressor is really hard. Every night I dream that if my life was snuffed out, I believe that my destiny would be eternity in the lake of fire. Every night almost, when I went to bed, I said, Lord, don't let me go into it. Don't let me die. And I went through that for years and years and years, because my mother was praying. She was praying. Sage James. They tried to get me to come to the altar. How many remember the altar days? They used to have a moaner's bench. You had to come up there and moan and praise God and let people, you know, work with you for a while to get the devil out, to get the Lord in, to get the power of Satan broken over your life. People had to work with you. And I believe that prayer. I have nothing wrong with working with folk. Amen. Praise God. But they didn't get a chance to work on me because I wouldn't go up there. And when I went up there, I just sat down and I wasn't there. I was hard as a rock. Sometimes I went to sleep up there while they were clapping and patting and trying to work over me. One day, the Lord, praise God, I woke up one morning with chills all over my body. And that day,
it was destined for me to find Christ. I went to church. It was a prayer meeting. I don't know how I got there. I don't know who invited me there, but somebody invited me to come. And I had made up my mind. I said, I'm still ain't gonna what? I'm still not gonna surrender. Praise God to God like they want me to surrender. That woman, one of the most spiritual sisters at that church, it was my mother and a sister that had the gift of prophecy. She had the gifts working. And I was up on that mourner's bench, and she said, "Death! That's what I fear. That's what I've been dreaming. Death! Death today!" And I thought I was going to die right there in that church. And I said, if I'm going to die and die today, I'm going to die seeking the Lord. For the first time in my life, I got rid of my pride, opened my mouth, began to scream and cry and call on the name of the Lord. About 5 or 10 minutes, the Lord had really broken me, got that pride out from me. Amen. And the anointing of God hit me all over. And I fell out. Just like I just didn't want to do. I didn't want to do that. I fell out. Started rolling on the floor. About 15 minutes, I was speaking in tongues. Kept speaking in tongues for about 3 hours. 2 or 3 hours. Hallelujah. After a while, that woman, she just kept on saying, "Death, death." I thought I was going to die. I thought she was saying that I was going to die and die today in that church. I said, "Well, if I die today, amen, I'm going to die saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost and with life." And later on, what God had given her. She says, "Death, death." She was talking about spiritual death. I was separated from God. That's what she meant. I was separated from God and I need to what? To be saved. I said, "Oh man, if I had known that, I wouldn't have tried this hard. I wouldn't have surrendered like that. I wouldn't have, praise God, broke up my face and amen and cried and rolled and got dirty and dusted. But the Lord has saved me and filled me with the Holy Ghost. I was going with this beautiful young lady right here. When I got saved, she was away for the summer. And I wrote her a letter. I said, "Something has happened in my life. Any man be in Christ is a new creature. Old things are past. I'm a different James. God came into my life. And my life is so sweet now." And when she got the letter, the Lord gave her a dream that night. Is that right? Gave her a dream. And in that dream, she said that although you grew up in the church, you were raised in the church, you participated in the church. I think that she played the piano a little bit. But the Lord said, she said, "Don't go there. She still needed Jesus." I go there. How many can say? And when she read that letter, God told her, showed her in a vision that she needed to receive the Lord. And she did. Came back to school and she received the Lord. And later on, she got filled with the Holy Ghost. She came back in September. And December 1st, amen, we got married. That was quick, wasn't it? Hallelujah. Happy life. All right, well, she's anyway, she's trying to clarify something, but that's all right. Everything may happen. If there's anyone today that want to make Jesus the Lord of your life, you know, we come together and share with people, and sometimes we do Bible lessons with them, but we just want to get over the message, what it means to be saved. Christ loves you. He gave his life. The scripture, I believe, that has been translated in how many different languages? Over 1,200 different languages. St. John 3:16. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, and whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." If God did it for Brother Henry, God did it for Brother Travis, God did it for Brother Hope, Sister Hope, Brother Beauty. Amen. And all of you others. Amen. God will do it for you. God has no respect of person. If I were you, I wouldn't put off today for tomorrow what I can do today. Amen. the Bible says that Satan is procrastination is the thief of souls. The day you hear, harden not your heart. So I want everybody today that would like to make Jesus Christ Lord of your life. If you really want to, amen, try Jesus. Somebody say, if you try Jesus and don't like it, the devil will take you back. Try Jesus. How about you say amen? Try Jesus. Try Jesus. I want everybody to stand, because I believe this is a very sacred moment, and I believe somebody here. Amen. Those that don't know Christ as the Lord of your life, is the pardon of your sin, this is your opportunity to say yes. Tomorrow, it might be too late. Your life is even as a vapor, it appeared for a time. Then you can just be what? Blotted away. Amen. That was the greatest fear that I ever contended with, death, before I would meet Jesus and make him Lord of my life. If you're here today and you want to make Jesus the Lord of your life, I invite you to come now. Amen. I invite you to come now. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. If you have any need, if you just need prayer, the Bible says that if two of you agree, it's touching anything that they shall ask. Whatever needs you have, whatever challenges you're facing, God wants to minister to your need. Just like all of these testimonies that we have heard, God has intervened in those lives in a specific way and brought them from darkness to light and has given them an inheritance among them that are sanctified. Some of these are the most faithful people. Amen. I never question. 5 o'clock, I don't feel like getting up. Not able to get up. Just amen. Oversleep. I know these doors are open on Tuesdays and Thursdays.
Amen. Amen.
But it was a brother that heard the word. From his wife.
Amen.
A testimony.
Amen.
No doubt I would have to still be getting up to make all of these prayer meetings and open the door for everybody. But because his wife gave her testimony and told him he needs to be saved and refused to live with him and sleep with him in that common law relationship.
Amen.
That's the reason why he's here today.
Amen.
Somebody stood for the truth. And I'm glad for the people that will stand for the truth.
Amen.
People that will say yes to the Lord.
Amen.
People that's willing to deny themselves and take up the cross to follow Jesus. Amen. I don't have to worry. Brother Daniel is back there somewhere. Amen. Somehow we connected with him. That had been a long time ago. Sister Ken probably told him. Went for that. I don't know who to call. This brother Wayne, amen, is off of his job. But because somebody shared that testimony and brought conviction, we have men like Brother Daniel, Brother Travis, Brother Curtis. Brother Curtis started out in this church. Whole family, right? Amen. Brother Curtis, he can tell you some stuff. But I'm glad that I obeyed God. How many can say amen?
Amen.
I want Brother Dunn and Sister. They want to become members. I'm just going to ask you to come on down. He said they want to become members of this church. We're going to ask them to come. And we're just so thankful for them. Oh, I was so blessed yesterday when I just sat and talked with them for about, I believe it was almost 2 hours. I feel ashamed I kept on that. Sister Hill always warned me of that. But I enjoyed it so. They get so pleasant. And good listeners. And he came over and worked on my cars about 2 or 3 hours. And boy, I'm telling you this. The gospel is the power of God. All right, Sister Butler, my Lord, I'm glad that y'all made contact. And I found out that y'all used to go to the same church. Amen. But we want everybody to receive them into fellowship today, because I believe that we have two beautiful people, a wonderful family, people that's willing to work. They even volunteer. They said that we would like to help with the church and ministry to keep things clean, to keep the yard in shape, and anything we can do to help. Boy, this is what I've been praying for a long time, for people to volunteer. Volunteer. Bro, Brother William Smith. Amen. Come on down here just for a minute. Sister Smith, come on down. Now, this is a couple here. Sister, come on down, because I just want y'all to say something. If you don't feel like this, okay. But this family here was a family that you won't believe that when they first came, I had to handle them with silk gloves almost, because they had been hurt at another church. Had to handle them with silk gloves, because I figured if I said a wrong thing, they're going to feel like I'm just like another preacher. Boy, they have turned out, I mean, they have done a bout face, and they, they volunteered to clean the church. Amen. Brother Walter, he also volunteered to help with the yard too, so he can kind of light you up a little bit, kind of give you a little bit more slack. Amen. And I don't have to worry about that yard being cut or this church being cleaned. Those days, they're going to call me early and say that we're ready to go and clean the church. How many know it's wonderful when you reach out and help people and bless people, share the word with them, and take time with them, and to handle, amen, to get them beyond their, amen, their weak state, and that thinking that, you know, churches are out to, amen, to further their, you know, their goals and things like that, and not concerned about people. Amen. Now, how do you feel about Pastor Hill now, the church? How do you feel? Woo! You got winning souls as well.